Dr. Pung Pung Hwang. Dr. Hwang is a distinguished research fellow and a renowned fish biologist in the Institute of Cellular and Organismic Biology, Taiwan. Dr. Hwang's major contribution is to comprehensively reshape our understanding of osmoregulation, a fundamental issue in fish physiology. He has over 150 publications and has earned 7,961 citations with a H index of 51.
First of all, thank you for the organizer to give me the opportunity to present my study. And I really very happy to learn so much from all of you talking about the aquaculture from the different view. And I'm from Taiwan. My topic, as you can see, is osmoregulation. It's a very basic research, but I'll try to connect my research to aquaculture. I think all of you know that the body fluid ionic homeostasis is very important for the normal operation of the cell activity and the physiological process in fish, as in mammal. And this issue is more challenging in fish because fish have to adjust their ion transport function to cope with the changing aquatic environment. And salinity is the major factor affect osmoregulation, but salinity also affect different physiological process and the final output of the aquaculture performance and the survival and the growth of the fish. But today I will focus on the osmoregulation and the energy metabolism related to the osmoregulation. First, I'll introduce the osmoregulation during acclimation to different salinity. As you can see, in human, kidney is the major organ for the osmoregulation. In fish, fish have a gill, kidney, and intestine for the response for osmoregulation. But among them, gill is the major organ. Instead of the kidney, carry out more than 90% of ion transport pathway. And you can see the slide, you can see some cell stand for the sodium pump. We call the ionocyte or mitochondrial rich cell. They are responsible for ion secretion, ion uptake, ammonia excretion, and acid base regulation. And here I show you the current model of ion transport utilities, gear ionocyte in fresh water. As we take a medaka, it's a euryhaline fish. As an example, as you can see, we identify different kinds of ionocyte. They express different set of the ion transport responsible for the transport ion. For example, we look at the NHE cell. This cell express NHE3 is a transporter. Also, the Rh protein is ammonia is a transporter. And this cell is responsible for the acid secretion, sodium uptake, and ammonia excretion. And the another cell, look at ECAC is responsible for calcium uptake. But if we look at the ionocyte in the seawater medaka, as you can see, it's quite simple. The major cell type we call the seawater ionocyte. This cell is responsible for the secretion of sodium and chloride, the major ion in the seawater. And they also respond for the ammonia excretion and acid base regulation, as what we found in the freshwater medaka. And next, I will show you some example to show the response of fish when they die or survive after they transfer to different salinity. We take Mozambique tilapia as an example. As you know, Mozambique tilapia can survive in the 35 ppt seawater. However, they cannot survive after you direct transfer to the 35 ppt seawater. They will die within 6 hours. So before the 6 hour, we look at what happened in the tilapia. As you can see, plasma osmolality sodium chloride concentration will increase rapidly during the before they die. And you can see that the major transporter sodium pump did not change, did not stimulate it before the fish died. But if the fish transfer to 20 ppt seawater, they survive so well. And then you can look at what happened. The plasma osmolality sodium chloride concentration will increase at first and then going down, recover to the level of the same as the control. And you can see, follow this change, the sodium pump activity, sodium pump expression in messenger RNA or protein will stimulate at the same time, just to support this change in the plasma parameter. And recently, we also take a metaca as an example to look at more the detail of this response. We established a mechanism we call non-invasive ion selective electrode to measure the real-time change of the sodium and chloride current in an intact fish. So as you can see, when we transfer the metaca from freshwater to seawater directly, you can see the sodium and chloride current are stimulated as quickly as 30 minutes after you transfer to seawater. And during the same time, we could not find any change in the expression of the transporter. We cannot find any change in the number of the ionocyte. So that means this rapid response, nothing related to the translation or transcription. Okay. And furthermore, we look at the hormone control of this very rapid response. As we all know, many hormones have been reported to control the ion regulation in fish. And when we look at the IGF, please don't take picture. This is unpublished data. Okay. And we found this, we use an inhibitor for the IGF-1. We found the stimulated sodium chloride current will inhibit after they transfer to seawater. So that means IGF-1 is a very important regulator for this active response of the salt secretion. So next, I would like to talk something about the local and the systemic energy supply to the osmoregulation in gear ionocyte. And we know, I shown the glycogen metabolism pathway. We know glycogen can be synthesized from the glucose through the glycogen genesis process. On the other way, the glycogen can be degraded into glucose as an energy substrate through the glycogen genolysis. And this glycogen metabolic cascade has been well studied in the liver. And however, we also found this glycogen metabolism also developed in the gear. We identified a new type of cell we call the glycogen-rich cell, because this type of cell contains a lot of the glycogen, just like a liver. And it always locate beside the ionocyte. We also identify the glycogen-related enzyme, metabolic enzyme, in this type of cell, like the glycogen phosphorylase or glycogen synthesis. We also demonstrate that when it emerges energy need, the glycogen in the glycogen-rich cell can be degraded into glucose and further converted to the lactate. And then the lactate can be transported to the neighboring ionocyte for their operation of the osmoregulation. And we also look at the long-term the change of this glycogen metabolism. as you can see, we show the glycogen content in the gill and the liver. After they transfer the fish or tilapia from freshwater to seawater, you can see that in the first 1 to 3 hours, the glycogen in the gill will quickly decrease and then a little bit recover. And after that, the glycogen in the liver is gradually decreased and the recovery. So that means glycogen in the gill may be as a local energy source, and the liver is a systemic energy source. So we propose that during the acute phase of the climation to the salinity stress, the glycogen in the glycogen-rich cell can be degraded into glucose and direct transport the energy to the neighboring ionocyte. But this glycogen storage in the glycogen-rich cell is very limited, so it's used up during the very short term, and then the liver glycogen will degrade it into glucose, provide glucose to the ionocyte, at the same time also provide the glucose to the glycogen-rich cell, and then the glucose will restore in the glycogen-rich cell and prepare for the next time emergency needed. So next, I would like to talk something about the salinity effect on the energy metabolism, food intake, conversion, and the growth. I think this is very important because the final output of the fish is very important related to the aquaculture. So there are many studies look at the salinity effect on the growth in fish. We look at a very old review. They compare the different kind of species. They found most of the euryhaline species a better growth appear at the intermediate salinity. But what is the possible mechanism behind this result? So it's very simple thinking. As you can see here, the metabolizable energy are allocated into different needs. For example, the basal metabolism and the production. Okay. When there is a salinity stress, if this salinity stress stimulate, increase the standard metabolism, then the energy allocated to the production will decrease. So that's very important. So for this reason, it's very interesting to look at the standard metabolism by measure the oxygen consumption under different salinity. You can see a lot of people, a lot of study look at the osmoregulation, look at the oxygen consumption rate in different salinity. However, only some of the euryhaline species show a lower standard metabolic rate at the intermediate salinity. So if we look at more detail of this respiration rate, we measure oxygen consumption at whole body. But we also can look at the respiration rate in an isolated tissue, isolated gill cell. That is the direct related to the osmoregulation. But we compare different study. We can find that this metabolic rate are depending on species, the situation of the acclimation, and all the life habit of the species. It generally about 20 to 5% of the total fish energy budget will propose to be associated with the osmoregulation. However, if you look at the isolated gear, we can find that this much lower level of the energy is related to the osmoregulation, maybe roughly less than 10%. So taken all together, we can consider that only metabolic rate appear not necessary to reflect the growth rate under different salinity. So we need to consider other factor that possible affect the growth. So I think the most important include the food intake, digestion, the food conversion. And actually, I am not an expert in this area, but I just review the paper and pick some example. As you can see, in the catfish, higher growth rate and the food conversion ratio was found at 10 ppt seawater. But in the case of the rabbit fish, salinity will suppress the growth but increase the food conversion efficiency. So you can see that the results are that depending on species and the situation of the experiment. But I found a very interesting paper. In this paper, they found that salinity will affect food intake and also show some effect on the growth rate, although it is not significant. But they found that the protein intake show a positive relationship with the feed conversion ratio. And this action of the effect of the protein intake is salinity dependent. And you can see in the higher salinity, the protein intake show higher effect on the feed conversion ratio. But it's not the case in the case of the feed. So that suggests that the protein metabolism rate protein intake is associated with feed conversion rate and maybe stimulate the growth. I found it makes sense because we also found some our recent unpublished data in the case of the ammonia excretion. As we all know, the ammonia excretion is the major way to exclude the nitrogen waste. This is mainly resulted from the protein metabolism. As you can see, from the zebra fish to medaka, zebra fish is a more primitive fish. Medaka is a more advanced fish. Okay, please don't take picture. This is a published paper, okay. You can see, following the evolution of the fish, the ammonia excretion rate is increasing, okay? But when we treat this fish with the low pH is a very harsh environment to the fish. You can see the ammonia excretion stimulated by the acidic stress, and this stimulation also increased following evolution of the fish as well as in the human. You can see this slide. This data is cited from a human paper. You also can see that ammonia excretion rate is very important, the major part for the energy for the waste exclusion, particularly in the acidic stress. So that I propose, if the adjustment of the protein metabolism is associated with the acclimation to a harsh environment, this is an open issue and need more study from the point of view of the physiology. So finally, I would like to make some conclusion the perspective. First, I found the euryhaline fish have developed sophisticated mechanism of osmoregulation to cope with a hyper or hypo-osmotic environment. The glycogen rich cell as a local energy source and the liver as a systematic energy source provide the energy to the operate the gear ion osmoregulation at acute and chronic phase, respectively, of the acclimation to salinity trace. Our current knowledge regarding the osmoregulation provides important basic information to understand the underlying mechanism of the survival growth and the aquaculture performance of the fish in different salinity. So as for the aquaculture, I suggest the most important thing is to determine the salinity for fish to optimize their growth and the quality. And the next, we're keeping a stable salinity with a less or slower fluctuation would benefit the aquaculture performance by minimizing the effect of the salinity stress on osmoregulation and other physiological process. Selecting the salinity tolerance fish stress is also a feasible way to benefit brackish water aquaculture. As you can see, we did some selection. We select a salinity tolerant, the tilapia. As you can see, the salinity SR, the strength, salinity tolerant the strength, showing a higher lower mortality compared to the wild type when they transfer direct to the salinity stress. And you also can see that the salinity resistance strain, they show better response in terms of the transporter expression when they expose to the salinity stress. So this is the end of my talk. Thank you for your attention.